What's going on, my good people? Mike Hidalgo here. Thank you for joining us on another FCP Euro DIY. Today, we're going to be working on a 2006 Porsche Cayman S987. Today, on the 987 behind us, we're going to be covering how to service your AOS system. In front of us, we have an air oil separator kit, which we have put together, which includes the separator, some lines, as well as some hardware. This is going to be applicable to your 986 Boxsters as well as your 987 Caymans, that ones. Now, typically these don't have a service interval. A good rule of thumb is every 10 years or 70 to 100,000 miles. The vehicle behind us is just about to roll over 100,000 miles and it's starting to show symptoms of a failing AOS. With that comes blue smoke at startup, excessive oil consumption. If you try to remove the oil fill cap while the engine is running and you feel a lot of suction, then more than likely the diaphragm in here has failed. Now, typically you can get away with just doing the separator itself. However, it is good to inspect the hoses going to the unit. If they're super crusty or the clips are broken or they're cracked anywhere, then you're gonna wanna replace them or if they break while you're doing the valve. Otherwise, you can probably reuse the ones in the car. Pay attention to the O-rings on them as well. If those are deteriorated, then you're gonna wanna replace the hose. The one thing we do encourage that you replace along with the separator is the elbow that connects it to the block down below. These can get hard and brittle over time. And since they're a bit hard to reach, you're gonna wanna do them while you're doing this job. Before we get started on this DIY though, let's take a look at some of the tools we're gonna need for this job. For this job, my good people, we're gonna be using a 3/8 drive torque wrench and ratchet. We also have an electric ratchet. A magnet tool is going to come in handy. We have an E10 and a T30 for our sockets. Super crucial are hose clamp pliers to make this job and your life a lot easier. If you can get some that lock, the locking ones are the move. We have a couple of extensions for our ratchets, a small trim removal tool, and super handy, a flashlight. Now with that, let's go ahead and get started on this DIY. All right, my good people, we're going to get started on the Cayman. A couple things to note I would recommend if you're going to be doing this job. A, start with a clean car. You're going to be rubbing up against the rear hips a lot. B, wear something soft. I have a nice soft t-shirt and some soft sweatpants, so I'm not worried about marring the paint on the vehicle. We're going to get our carpeting off first. I'm just going to use a trim removal tool to get underneath the front lip here on the carpet. There's two tabs on the back of it that key into here. Not anything crazy, but it just grabs on a little bit harder in the back if you're trying to start it from back there. Lift it up, and then we'll just set our carpeting slash insulation over to the side. Once we have the carpeting off, we can see the metal cover here. We have 5 T30s holding this down. We're just gonna go ahead and zap them out. And then we can go ahead and pull our cover off and set it to the side with our carpeting. Now we have our cover off. We have a better view AOS, which is right here. We can see the crank breather lines going to it. We can see one of the Torx bolts, the other one's a little bit hidden. So we're gonna start by separating some lines, then we'll take off some hardware and go from there. First thing we're gonna do, my good people, is use a little bit of compressed air to just blow the area around the AOS and where it seals before we take anything apart and open up any of the systems here. Be mindful if your engine bay is super filthy like ours is. If you're using compressed air, there's a chance you can get some dirt and debris inside the car. Now this thing's in dire need of a detail, so I'm not too worried about that today, but just keep that in mind. First things first is we're gonna start by disconnecting the top breather line. You'll notice on the lines there is a ridge spot on this outer clip, one on either side. Those are going to be your pinch points to release the tabs on the top and bottom, in this case, to free this hose from the AOS. So with one hand, we're going to pinch, and with our other hand, we're going to help pull back. And just like that, we should be able to go ahead and pop that off. Now, it's normal to see a little bit of oil inside of the line. In this case, I'm just suspecting we're going to see quite a bit inside this unit as it has started showing signs of failure. But for now, we're going to go ahead and tuck that to the back. And now we're going to head down to the passenger side bank of the AOS down below here and tackle the next line. Same idea, two pinch points. This one's a little bit more trickier because the pinch points are on the top and bottom. So we're gonna do our best to show you that first, and then we'll reach in and work those out. So what becomes the issue with this bottom hose here is that there's no real good way to get your finger underneath the bottom ridged press portion. So what we're gonna do instead is we're gonna undo the two E-Torx that hold this valve in place. And we're gonna work on disconnecting that hose. Once we have a little play in the actual valve, we can bring it up a little bit. There's enough flex in the hose to disconnect it. Then we can reach our fingers underneath. Speaking of that, the AOS has a rubber elbow at the bottom, which we showed you at the beginning, that connects it to the block. That is held in by two constant pressure clamps. Now, I am banking on the idea that this rubber elbow is nice and dry and worn out. So when I undo the two E-Torx, I'm gonna do the unconventional thing and just pull up on the valve and see if it will separate itself from our rubber elbow, which we are replacing, and I highly recommend you do as well. And if that does not work, then we'll reach underneath and we'll undo some clamps to get that out. So it's a little unconventional, but since we are replacing all of this, no problem. So let's grab our E-Torx now and we'll work on pulling those two bolts out. We have two E10s that we need to tackle down here. So we're gonna go down with our extension and we'll start with the front one, which is super easy to get to. Have your magnet tool handy to fish these out. These are also recommended to be replaced every time you do this job. The new ones come with a little bit of Loctite on them, ready to rock. With that out, I'm gonna take my magnet tool and fish it out. Now we're gonna go for our back one, which is hidden between the AOS and the part of the engine harness. You can see we're gonna feed the extension down. That should give you a little bit of a better idea where this sits. Now we'll take our magnet tool and fish out our bolt. And now we're gonna try to pop the AOS up just enough that we can reach the bottom line here. Again, being mindful of the idea that the elbow down below can tear, which we are gonna replace, or it may not let us pull this up at all. Beautiful, that's exactly what we wanted. Now at this point, we can reach the bottom and top tab here and try to separate this line. While we wrestle this line off, I'm gonna go ahead and take a towel and just plug the opening down to our crankcase just to avoid anything dropping down there. While we wrestle this off, twisting the valve a bit back and forth to help break the seal. There we go. And here is our old valve. We can see the bottom where we pulled it out of the rubber L down below, or the elbow hose, which is totally fine. Again, we are replacing it. Not ideal, but it works. Let's set this to the side, and now we can work on getting our bottom L hose out. Now we're gonna go in and we're gonna work on removing our elbow down below. I'm gonna go in at an awkward angle and reach in with our pliers to see if I can get that hose clamp to separate it from the block. And then we can work on pulling it out. With our hose clamp undone, we can go ahead and pull this elbow up. We're just gonna work it off the block, twist it to break the seal, and up it comes. We're gonna wanna note the orientation of the elbow as well. At the bend, the longer portion goes to the block, the shorter portion goes to our AOS. So now comes the fun and tricky part. We're gonna install our new hose the way we just took this one out, and then we're gonna keep this clamp down below a little bit, and we're probably gonna have to reach from underneath the car to get this clamp situated, but we'll worry about that in just a moment. For now, let's get our new hose, get it clamped onto the block, and we'll go from there. I'm gonna go ahead and feed the hose in. You'll notice there's a white mark on the elbow that's gonna point up, lines up with the tab on the casing. Beautiful. The goal is not to see any shiny from the block. Now we're gonna feed in our clamp. We have our hose clamp pliers already gripped around the clamp here. And once we have our clamp where we want it, we're gonna release the pliers. It's probably gonna be the hardest thing here. And now we're just gonna get our secondary clamp situated, maybe down here below, just out of the way so that there is enough, there's no pressure on the tip of our hose here when our new PCB goes in, or our new AOS. So let's go ahead and do that now. Now at this point, we're gonna make sure that the whole tour crankcase looks good. That looks fine in there, nothing funny or anything in the way. We'll give it a gentle wipe, pulling out versus in, trying not to drop anything into the crankcase, just getting any loose debris off. The important part is that it seals, the O-ring seals on the inside, so I'm not too worried about anything on top here. Now with that nice and clean, we can start fitting our new valve in, get this bottom line plugged in, and we're also gonna be mindful that we can get the end of the AOS valve in here. We're gonna lubricate that with a little bit of dielectric grease. You can always use a little bit of engine oil, and we'll do the same thing for the O-ring that sits here. All right, we're gonna slowly feed our valve in. While we have the play, we're gonna go ahead and connect our breather line down below. Now we're gonna work on feeding it down as evenly as possible. There's probably no chance we're gonna line it up with the hose, but at least we'll get it in the block. Then we can reach underneath from below the car and get our hose on. We're looking right now for our O-ring to situate itself into the block. All right, at this point, trying to pull up on it, I can feel that that O-ring is seated, which is what we want. I'm rotating it left and right a little bit just to make sure it's not rolled or pinching itself. And while we have it here, we're gonna go ahead and feed down our two new E10s and torque those down to 13 Newton meters. We're gonna go ahead and feed our E10 down. I'm just using a magnet tool to get that in place. I'm gonna turn it a bit with the magnet tool and hoping that the bolt will catch. And if not, no problem. We'll just slide the magnet tool off of it. And I'll go in with my actual socket and extension and just let it grab a few threads. Okay, beautiful, that one started. Now let's get our rearward bolt started. It's gonna be a little bit more tricky. We'll get that one fed in as well. Slide the magnet tool off. And now we'll get that one started as well with our socket and extension. Now we're gonna take our ratchet and just snug these both down, and then we'll torque them down to 13 Newton meters. Beautiful. Now that's situated, we can go ahead and plug in our upper hose while that is nice and fixed to the block. These hoses are in good shape, so we're not worried about replacing them. Should you want to replace the bottom line though, you would want to remove the pipe here going to our plenum from the throttle body, and that would give you all the room to snake in the new one and take out the old one. The old one clips in to the front of the head behind the driver's seat. You can't really see it, but you can feel the pinch points on the line. So not terrible, but not something we need to dive into today for this car. But if you really want to see it, my good people, leave it in the comment section below and we'll come back to it. There's that one. Now I'm just going to reach underneath. I can see my hose clamp and I can see my pliers, but I'm not sure if the valve went into the hose. It's a little hard to tell. So now we're going to go ahead and get underneath the car, take a better look at what's going on with the hose, and situate that hose clamp. From down beneath the car, my good people, on the right side, you have a clear shot view, not so much to reach, but to see what happened to the elbow underneath the AOS. In our case, I had lubed up the tip of the valve, and it luckily just slid into place into our new hose. So now all I have to do is work the clamp up into position and get our pliers out, which is a little bit easier said than done when you get some big meat Johnson's like me, but we're gonna go ahead and reach in. I'll give you the best view we can of what that looks like. And again, I can't stress enough how crucial these hose clamp pliers are, especially the lock-in ones. They make this job so much easier. So with that, let's get this last clamp on. All right, my good people, at this point, our valve is in. We're gonna go ahead and install our cover once more. Just gonna go ahead and feed this in. Front first, then the bottom. We'll get all five T30s started by hand. then we can install our carpet insulation. We got this in, we'll feed the back tabs of the carpet in first. Make sure our cargo hooks are all up and out. And that, my good people, is gonna conclude this DIY for today. Overall, not a terrible job on the 987. 986 might be a little bit tighter, putting the soft top into service mode, but otherwise, pretty similar process. If you like this video, please be sure to give it a thumbs up. If you have any questions or comments on what we did today, or there's a specific DIY you wanna see us do on the 987 chassis, leave that in the comments section below. And if you like this DIY and you wanna see more like them, please consider subscribing. We make new ones all the time. As always, thank you so much for watching. We'll catch you in the next one.